My name's Jeff Smith. I own Loaded Dice Brewery with my wife, Jennifer, and I'm also the head brewer. I've been a home brewer for about 20 years. I started home brewing a little bit when I lived in Michigan, but then I moved out to California. And then that's when I really started getting into it. I didn't know anybody, and the guys I worked with brewed, played poker. So every weekend we just went over to someone's house and we barbecue or brew and play poker. And we all started just elevating our game. We went from extract to full mash to where we threw in all our money and bought a, you know, pretty complex system. And we were just brewing every few weekends and just getting together and having a good time. I always knew I was going to branch out and do something on my own. It just seemed like a thing I've always wanted to do. I like the fact that I can kind of control my own destiny here. And when we were trying to figure out what that thing was going to be, because I come from a tech background, I didn't want to do anything software or anything like that. And the other option was doing a barbecue restaurant, and I thought opening a brewery would be easier. I think any home brewer gets in and starts brewing and is like, I could own a brewery. So I think it happened very early on. It just seemed almost impossible, because you'd go into breweries and they're like these huge, you know, beautiful places, and it seemed like it just took a ton of money to open them up. And I've met a few brewers along the way that opened up, you know, a little bit more grassroots and just kind of built upon the opening, getting the beer out there to people, and kept elevating their game. So when I did that and saw and started talking to other brewers who opened up for a small budget, it seemed very attainable. The original idea was doing something a little bit further north off of 75, because I thought it was a little bit of a barren area. And one of the brewers I was talking with was a brewery in Ludington. So we would go up north quite a bit along 75, and we would get, you know, somewhere where it's like, well, we kind of were back on this side of town, and, you know, we wanted to get something to eat, or we wanted to go to a brewery or something. There was really nothing there right off of 75. So that was the original thought and concept. And that was, you know, we're going to do something small, tap room related only, no food, we'd do food trucks, you know, but we felt like that was a good area to go. When we started really doing investigations and, you know, where we wanted to go, Troy just kind of started to make a little sense for us. We both, my wife and I, live and work in Troy. Our kids go to Troy. We're pretty well connected in the community. You know, I coach lacrosse. Jen, my wife, is big into the PTO on both the schools that the kids go to. So we felt like it made sense for us to pick Troy. It seemed kind of natural that we would do something gambling related. So we kind of ran through the common names, like, you know, Full House Brewery, you know, Lucky Strike, you know, things of that nature, and it just didn't fit. And my favorite game in playing, you know, when I go to a casino, is playing craps. So I started looking up craps terminologies, and, you know, pass line, brewing, place to eight kind of stuff, and Loaded Dice just stuck out. We narrowed it down to probably three or four other ones, and we took kind of like, straw poll amongst friends and family, and that's the one that we all landed on. And I think the gambling theme is almost like an open book, to where we have a lot of things that we can do with it, not just from like a naming convention way, but we can play off, you know, the different gambling themes, gambling movies. There's a lot of avenues that we can go with it. It's a pretty wide open brand, I think. I think my personality comes out a lot in the beers. You're gonna get something that's a little goofy, something that's gonna challenge you, something you're just gonna look at and go, what the hell is this? So on that note, we release one of our big flagships is the Fat Kings. So there's three different ones in the series. There's the Birth of the Fat King, and the Death of the Fat King. And we released those on the anniversary of Elvis's death and birth. So this past August, he passed away in August. We released the three, which the new one was the Death of the Fat King. And they kind of elevate in character and flavor. We add peanut butter, banana, and bacon in each beer. Each beer is kind of a growth of each one. So the Birth of the Fat King is a little bit more milder, a little bit more banana forward because of how I ferment it. Lighter in color, lower in ABV. The Fat King is the one I've brewed, you know, time and time again as a home brewer. It placed in a few home brewing competitions. I've won some medals with it. So that's kind of the root recipe. That's gonna be a little bit more evenly, you know, a little bit more in the smoky end of it. And then the Death of the Fat King is actually kind of like a dark wheat wine that's about 10-11%, just pounded with banana chips and banana puree and peanut butter and bacon. So we release those twice a year, and it's kind of become like, now we're starting to get that notoriety for that beer. And we have a few others. We have Juicy Side Bet, which is our flagship New England IPA. Hef Smoking Jacket, which is a smoked Hefeweizen. Use cherry wood smoked malt to bring out that kind of really nice campfire kind of taste and feel with it. Another one that we produce quite a bit is our One Last Bet Lager. So it's kind of a play on a lager. It's really, we use an ale yeast because it's a quicker turnaround for us, but it still clears out. It's still very good. In Dank Vegas, we come out 3 times a year. So the main release is 420. Then we do it on 820 and 1220. So those are the kind of the ones that we kind of earmarked as flagships. But when I opened, I vowed that I would try to do 100 different batches in a year. And I'm at like 87, and we just had our year anniversary. I think it's a lot more fun to have that rotating tap list. You know, as a beer enthusiast, I would love going into the tap rooms over and over again, but it was always the same 6 to 8 beers, and I wanted something different. You know, I've had that IPA that you made, I've had that Hefeweizen. So it, to me, I think it lends kind of a cool experience coming in. You kind of know what you're gonna get, but you don't really know until you get here. The tap list kind of rotates through every 2 to 3 weeks. We brew in a small batch to kind of do that. And that allows us, I think, to adapt and kind of see where trends are going. And also we want the feedback too. So there's some beers that I just put out. Someone wanted an amber lager, I have that on tap now. So home game lager. I do like a stout series that has different adjuncts and flavorings. And that's usually feedback that we get. What flavors do you want to hear be in this stout? The same thing with the seltzer that we make. So Jen makes the base seltzers, and based upon people's recommendations, we flavor it according to that. Year two, as we go into it, which is still shocking considering everything we've been through to open, we're really gonna start honing in on like those flagships. So we have 10 taps. The plan is to have at least 4 flagships on all the time, and we'll rotate through those to kind of keep that kind of like, don't know if Red 5 is gonna be on today, kind of a thing. So I think a lot of people like that, the mystery around that. And then the other 6 are gonna be just, if I find a new hop, I'll make a New England IPA out of it. If I feel like I wanna do, another fruity pebble beer, I'll do that. So it's gonna be a little bit of the same, but just a twist on it to kind of, I have to have something to stabilize. I have to start, remaking beers again and again, because I think the novelty of that is kind of, I don't wanna say it's wearing off, but in order for me to grow, and if I ever do want to have distribution, which still seems like miles and years away, I have to have that consistent beer that's known. So if you get Juicy Side Bet, let's say at a Meyer in Gaylord, you can come down here and Juicy Side Bet will be on tap likely. So that's kind of where we're trying to get to in year two. So we do an annual mug club, which I think is a little unique and fun. I found this guy who makes mugs up in Traverse City named Skyler the Potterer. He's amazing. He did the Founding 50 mugs, and he did last year's annual mug clubs, and he did this one again. And we just opened it up about 3 weeks ago. It's still available until, I think we're cutting it off September 26th. It's all the same type of benefits that you would get in a mug club. You get 10% off merchandise, you get a little bit larger fill, you get $4 off of to-go 6-pack, invites to special events, you get any special release, you guys get first crack at it. But beyond that, at the end of the year, so every year we'll have like a party, everybody gets to come in, pick one of the mugs that they liked or spotted or identified as their mug, and go home with it. So every year then the mug changes. So last year we had a black, skinny, tallish mug. This year we got a little bit more squatty, red glazed, shiny, it has dice imprints in it. I think it's just a fun thing because I haven't seen that in any brewery that I've been a mug club with. It's always, you got a mug that sits at the house, or some of the mugless clubs, you just get a pool of mugs that you can pick from. But being able to take it home kind of adds like a little bit to that kind of Pokemon, I gotta collect them all kind of thing, which is fun. And I think because I change them out, it's giving people some ownership with it too. So we're located on Rochester Road, 1725 Rochester Road, Troy, Michigan, 48083.